African American women are more likely than white women to be diagnosed with breast cancer before age 40. The Women's Ministry is forming a team to participate in the second annual Sister Strut Breast Cancer Walk. Sister Strut aims to heighten awareness about the issues of breast cancer in women of color. The walk is Saturday, May 18th. The rally starts at 8 a.m. and the walk starts at 10 at LaFleur's Bluff Park, State Park. The cost is $33.50 per person. Please see Deidre Johnson if you have any questions. Ladies, it's time to have fun fellowshipping with your sisters in Christ. The Women's Ministry presents an all-white day party on Saturday, April 27th, 2:30 p.m. at The Rock. Oh, we will dance, eat, and just fellowship with one another. Please wear all white casual clothing, and you may scan the QR code to register for this amazing event. And of course, The Rock is located at 1909 Bowling Street in Jackson. Join Pastor Vincent Russell for Wednesday night Bible study beginning at 7 o'clock p.m. Corporate prayer begins at 6:45. Come out ready to receive a deeper understanding of the Word of God. And simultaneously, the Salt and Light Ministry will be meeting in Spans Hall. If you'd like your ministry or event to be included in the morning announcements, that deadline is Wednesday by noon. And a very happy and special birthday to one of my favorite sisters, Evelyn Richardson. And that is what's happening at The View. Peace and blessings.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Everybody come to give God some praise, right? All right. It's a good thing. Psalms 22 and 3 says, "But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel." Everybody has heard that God dwells in the habits of his people. You know, we don't have to sing all the time just to give God praise. I can walk, and the way that I carry myself, I'm giving God praise. I can talk. The way that I'm talking, I give God praise. I can sit down sometime at home and just write my thoughts down, and I'm giving God praise. So anytime that we give God praise, he comes from the heavens, and he dwells on the inside of us. We are in his full presence. Is it anybody in here that likes to be in the presence of the Lord? Is it anybody in here that loves to be in the joy of the Lord? Yeah, make some noise for the Lord in here today. This is your call to worship.
Yes, God. Glory to your name, God. Thank
you. Our scripture which says, "But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. And above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. Use hospitality one to another without grudging. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another, as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If any man speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as the ability which God giveth. That God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen." May God bless the readers, hearers, and doers of his holy word.
Praise the Lord. We're going to ask you to stand this morning for our hymn. Oh, how I love Jesus. There is. Say, oh,
oh, how I love Jesus.
Sing it from your heart.
Oh, how I love Jesus.
We're singing, oh,
oh, how I love Jesus.
Because
he first loved me.
Verse 2 says, it tells me of
tells
a Savior's love.
For this day, we thank you for your love, your kindness, and all your protection. We thank you for your grace and mercy you've had on every one of us. We thank you for keeping us safe along the dangerous highways, Lord. Bless those that couldn't be here today, and also bless those who came. Lord, forgive us for our sins, because we know we have sinned and fallen short of your glory. So we ask you to better us and let your will be done in all of our lives. We thank you, we praise you, and we magnify your name. And we ask that according to these things, your will, you would do these things or something better. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
How many of you need the Lord?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. How many of you ask the Lord to be with you on this day?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Tomorrow gonna take care of tomorrow. But this day, the song simply says, I need him to rest right here in my heart. And when Jesus rests, I'm at peace. Is that all right? I need some worshipers in the house to pop on your feet. that can join in with us this morning. That says, like the dew in the morning, gently rest upon my heart. Like the dew in the morning, gently rest upon my heart. Like the dew. Break right here. I'm not gonna ask you to turn to your neighbor, but if you don't mind, just smile at him. Just smile at him. And what I want you to do this time, I want you to encourage somebody and say, like the dew in the morning, may he rest upon your heart. Like the dew in the morning, may he rest. We say yes, yes, Jesus. Oh yes. because he first loved me. A wretch undone, not fit, not worthy, but he loved me first. He loved me first. We can talk about love, y'all, but there's no greater love than the love God has for us. Hallelujah. How many of you can you say you love him more than anything? To know that he loves you, can you say that you love him more than anything? I lift my hands in total adoration to you. Upon the throne, for you are God and God alone. Because of you, my cloudy days are gone. I can sing to you this song. I just want to say that I love you more than anything.
Just
it really don't matter who's standing next to you. This is your love.
fruit of your lips, can you give God a worship? Just speak whatever it is that you need from the Lord right now. In this house, can we just fill this house with, I love you, I love you, I love you. Thank you, Jesus. We bless your name, God.
Of the music ministry. Amen. That sounds good coming out of our young people's mouths. Amen. We give you more. Well, I greet you this morning in divine love. I want to say to our visitors, you are indeed welcome. And I was told that Pastor Lonnie Wesley is here. I'm looking for you. Stand up. Stand up. Your family with you. Amen. Come on, stand up. Amen. We thank God Pastor Wesley is a part of this family. He pastors in Jacksonville. Pensacola. Amen. He pastors in Pensacola, a phenomenal, great man of God. Amen. Love the Lord. And he's a part of our ministry. So we are glad, sir, that you're with us this morning. God bless you. And amen. God keep you. And pray blessings upon you and your ministry in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, family, this morning, we're praying. Mother Johnson has come home from the hospital and Mother Chris Gibson. Amen. They're home from the hospital this morning. We're praying for Brother Darnell Brown, who is in St. Dominic, and we're praying for Sister Ann Richardson. Her last name has left me. Praise the Lord. But y'all know Sister Ann. Amen. She's having surgery, I think, this morning. I've tried to reach out to her already. Pray for her as well. We're keeping them lifted up in prayer. And how many of you were able to attend the small lung cell cancer session on yesterday? Was it not a blessing? Amen. We had over 100 members that were present with us yesterday. It was great. We had representatives here from HEAL, nonprofit out of Atlanta, and Amgen, pharmaceutical company, the maker of medicine. It was just a great, great, great session. We need to do more within our communities. And we just thank God. Listen, that information was eye-opening yesterday. Amen. If you did not get it, we may be doing it again or doing it with a different group. But listen, we thank God for our connection. Deacon Dietrich Taylor, amen. He's the responsible for us being even knowing them. Amen. Amen. And we thank God for what happened on yesterday. And I pray that each and every one of us, we use that information. We need to get an audience with our young people to share that information. Amen. A lot of young people are thinking, I don't smoke cigarettes. I'm vaping. I'm smoking black and mild. It's worse. It's worse. Young men are showing up in the ERs with third and fourth stage lung cancer, not knowing it, in their late 20s. So we need to share that information. Well, amen. Listen, moving on, next Sunday, starting next Sunday, the Mighty Men of Valor and the Young Mighty Men of Valor, they wanted me to announce that they're going to be wearing their Mighty Men of Valor green shirts, the polo shirts. Amen. Each and every third Sunday, starting next Sunday. So you all come on, represent in the house. I love it when our ministries, they're branded and they come in the house and they display what they're doing. Like today, our Women of Excellence are represent. Would it be you, Sister Brother Seller? Someone making emphasis today for the young? Amen. Sister Deidre. Deidre will be coming today to talk about what the Young Women of Excellence are doing. But all of our congregational ministries, I want to make certain that all of our members, you don't join the congregational ministries. Because you're a member of the church, you are automatically a member of Salt and Light, SWAP, MORE, Young Women of Excellence, Women of Excellence, Young Mighty Men of Valor, Mighty Men of Valor, and PALS. By virtue of being a member of the church, you are automatically a part of those ministries. So we ask that you make certain that you participate. Because when you don't show up, it's not that you haven't joined that ministry. You're just absent. Amen? So come on, Sister Deidre. Amen.
Ladies, excuse me, just a few reminders. We will be participating in the Susan G. Komen Breast Cancer Walk on Saturday, May 18th at 8 a.m. Sorry. If you like to participate, the Young Women of Excellence and the Women of Excellence, we will be having a team. To sign up, you can go to sisterstrut.org and you would choose the Jackson, Mississippi link. And we already have created a team. You will find our team. It's called the Women of Excellence. And you can sign up there. You can pay there. It's $33.50. That includes your T-shirts and a backpack. We really, really, really would like for all of our women and young women to come out and help us support this cause, because as we all know, in some way we have all been impacted, or someone we know and love has been impacted by breast cancer. If we can get our shirts back in time, our plan is to have Women of Excellence, Greater Fabby Women of Excellence, put on the back of our shirts. But that's if they're back in time. If not, that's fine too. We'll do it later. But we really would like you all to participate if possible. Lastly, ladies, I want you, excuse me. As you all know, when we know we're gonna get ready to have us a good time, we kind of get our clothes and things laid out early. I want you to lay your all white out so you can meet us on Saturday, April the 27th at The Rock at 2:30. We're having a all-white day party for the women and young women of excellence. Ladies, there's no excuse not to come. We make time to do the things that we want to do. So we will be, as a ministry, coming together to laugh, have fun, and of course, as you know, we love to do, eat in Greater Fabview style. So make sure you put that on your calendar for April the 27th, Saturday, 2:30 is the all-white day party for the women and the young women of excellence. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Deidre. Come on, let's give her a hand. I ask that each of you again participate with our congregational ministries. Amen. Well, listen, it's offering time in the house of the Lord. Anybody ready to give this morning? Amen. The word of the Lord tells us in Luke 6:38 to give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. God loves a cheerful, hilarious giver. And this morning, we thank God, amen, that we are ready to give. If you desire to give electronically, you are able to text GFView to 77977. That's 77977. Amen. Let us stand this morning as we prepare to give. Amen. Amen. Father, this morning, we bless you, praise you, and thank you for the opportunity to give this morning. We thank you, Father, that you are so gracious, so good to us. You give us bread to eat, seed to sow, and you multiply our seed sown. Father, this morning, as we come into this house to worship you and give it, we've come to bring back, amen, to you your tithe and our offerings. We ask this morning that your hand would be upon every family, every single, every couple, every entrepreneur, every manager, supervisor, every employee, everyone that may be looking. We ask in the name of Jesus that your hand be upon us to continue to demonstrate your love and your power through us. Thank you as a church family that we are blessed. And because we're blessed, you've increased us, Father, to be a blessing in this community. So we give you all the glory, honor, and praise for it. In Jesus' name. This morning, why don't you lift up your devices, your offerings, your seed, and repeat after me. I'm moving to a new level in my living. Because I'm moving to a new level in my giving. I expect nothing but the best from my God. And his best includes a threefold blessing. Increase, overflow, and favor. All three are all right with me. Now wave those gifts to the Lord. You may be seated as I usher ministry to you in our world. Thank you. always spotlight our youth. So at this time, we're going to ask Sister Liz, Amen, and Sister DeAngelique if they would come and present to us our youth spotlight for this morning.
And this morning, we're going to start off strong with Robert Williams Jr., better known as RJ. RJ is the son of Deshara Jackson and the grandson of Gloria Jackson. He attends Milo Collegiate Elementary School, where he is in the first grade and a straight A student. RJ also plays soccer, takes kung fu, and sings in the church choir. RJ was recently announced as the first place winner for the MAP Measures of Academic Progress test and made one of the highest scores. He made one of the highest scores on the STAR Early Literacy Assessment. He made a 902 out of 1100. Congratulations, RJ.
Good morning. Next we have Brother Joshua Walker. Josh auditioned and was chosen as a member of the Sonic Boom of the South. So Josh has no formal band training. He actually taught himself and prepared and committed himself to be a part of his lifelong dream, to be a part of the drum line, and he will be playing the tenor drums. So let's give it up for Josh.
Greatness stays in that family. If I can get Joseph Walker to stand as well. Joseph will be inducted into the National Honor Society of Clinton High School Monday, April the 15th, 2024. The National Honor Society recognizes leadership, service, character, and scholarship among high school students. Students must have a required 3.0 GPA, among other criteria. Joseph, believe it or not, has a whopping 3.83. Playing two varsity sports. He's a football starter and team leader, as well as basketball. He is a member of Salt and Light and the Young Mighty Men of Valor. Congratulations.
Next we have Kennedy Nicole Harris. She had it. So Kennedy is a junior at Jackson Academy. She was named cheer captain for the upcoming school season. y'all gonna set up on this. So she actually made history. She was the first African American
We got another great family. Can Nicholas join her? Let's say Nicholas Austin Harris. Nicholas Austin Harris is a senior at Jackson Academy. He is the first football player chosen for the draft for the MAIS All-Star Football Game and unanimously named Best Defensive Lineman by all MAIS coaches. Nicholas has received awards such as All-Conference and All-State, given to only a select few in the conference. He was also named All-State in soccer and took first place last week in the big man race during a track meet held at MRA. That's awesome.
Brother Omari Hart. He was the winner of Are You Smarter Than a Mustang in the subject area of Algebra 1. So this was a test prep game, so focus on various subject areas such as English, U.S. history, and biology, and prepare students to successfully pass their upcoming state test. Let's give it up for Omari.
It's Algebra 1, y'all.
So he actually went viral with over a million views, and he did what you call a promposal, and so it's actually a viral thing that he's done. So let's give it up for Kai.
Let's give it up one more time for our song Life. Pleasure in recognizing our babies, your babies, in the awesome things that they're doing in school and academics in the community. So we want a chance to spotlight all the rest of our other Soft Life members. If you would like your child or grandchild to be spotlighted in the spotlight, please make sure you get the information to us the Thursday before the second Sunday each month. And you can give that information to myself, Angelique, or Brother Jason. We have to have it by Thursday so we can get it all approved. Thank you.
We have a Hall of Fame here at Raider Fabric. Come on, let's give it up for our young people. Amen. So much time is spent talking about what young people are not doing. Here at Raider Fabric, we are celebrating what our young people are doing. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Well, listen, it's time for the word. You know, I know it's second Sunday, but baby, would you come and sing something, a hymn or something? Amen. We're not going to do, are you ready for the word? Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you. This will be our sermonic solo.
Amen. Well, this is old. Lord, I want to live for Thee every day and hour. Let me walk close to Thee. In its saving power, oh, keep my heart, keep my hands, keep my soul. My tongue to speak.
Lord, keep my hands, keep my soul, I pray. Oh, keep my tongue to
receive this word with my mind only, this word will be dead for me. But if I receive this word with the spirit over my mind, over my emotions, and over my fleshly desires, this word will be life for me. Lord, I don't need religious form and fashion. I need life. Tell somebody, get some life today. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your anointing. Father, I decrease that you may increase. You get the glory. Make my tongue the pen of a ready writer, ready to write the words upon the hearts of this thy people. And I pray that we'll open our hearts today, Father God, with faith and receive your word. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would turn to James chapter 1. Never heard that song, but I like it. Praise you, man. James chapter 1. Hallelujah. We're picking up from where we left off last Sunday. James chapter 1. We're going to begin reading at verse 1. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes scattered abroad, greetings. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God to give to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Drop down to verse 12. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. And the word of the Lord is blessed. You may be seated. This morning, I want to pick up on part two. We're talking about the work of patience. The work of patience. And if you didn't get last week's message, you can log on. You can go online. You can look at it. It's still out there. We talked about falling into diverse temptations. And we talked about that the word temptation is not meaning that you're tempted necessarily to sin. But we're talking about various tests and trials that will come in the life of a believer. We also talked about Job last week as an example, how Job went through what he went through. But the difference is when we read Job, we are privy to a conversation that happened before Job's trial started, but Job wasn't privy to that conversation. But we also talked about in the life of a believer that the scripture says here that know this, that the trying of your faith, it's your faith. When you name the name of Jesus, you then have made yourself qualified and a candidate for the devil to come and try your faith. We also talked about last week when things happen sometimes in your life and a trial or temptation comes, sometimes people will come to you and ask you, what did you do wrong? People will sometimes tell you God is mad at you. That's not what the scripture says. Job was an upright man. As a matter of fact, God offered Job. He said, have you considered my servant Job? Ain't none like him. This boy is faithful. He does what he's supposed to do. So don't think when something happens in your life or trial comes your way that it's like God is mad at you and he's got a stick and he's paying you back. So let's go on here. The Bible says in verse 5, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, which gives to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and shall be given unto him. Let me say this. In order for you to understand that when trials come your way, that it's not that you've done something wrong, in order for you to understand that this is a trying of your faith, and understanding that you have to let patience have a perfect work, the Bible says that you have to have wisdom. You have to understand that. Because listen, most times, everybody in here, look at me. When something bad happened in your life, the first thing we want is it to stop. Can I get a witness? We want it to stop. Take it away. Paul said, take this thorn away. God replied and said, my grace is sufficient. In the life of a Christian, if you really know God, if you really have any experience with God, if you've really walked with the Lord, what you need to begin doing when a trial comes your way, you know, the Bible says the name of the Lord is a strong tower. You run there, you're safe. But at the same time, you begin to testify that I'm coming out of this. Because, see, Job had to tell his friends, He had to tell his wife, you sound like you crazy. But at the end, Job got double for his trouble. And folks sometimes don't want to walk past you, walk beside you when you're going through. They want to brag and shout with you on the other side. But when something goes on and a trial come your way, don't you look, don't bunker there, don't camp. What you do is you begin to understand that, listen, I got to let patience have a perfect work. If we haven't gone through anything, we're not developed. Some of us, you know today, if you hadn't gone through the stuff that you've been through, you'd be a wreck. You'd be a mess. But God is faithful. And see, that the reason I don't get upset is because he said he'd never leave me. He said he's going to come and he's going to be with me. So wherever I am, Daniel in the lion's den, wherever I am, he's there. The Hebrew boys in the fiery furnace, wherever I am, he's with me. But when you ask for this wisdom, he say, ask in faith, nothing wavering. He said, for he that wavered is like the waves of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. Don't be double-minded. Don't be double-minded. Double-minded is almost signs of being bipolar. I'm confessing this, but I'm doing this. When church is going on and praise and worship start, I'm testifying about he's sure enough a deliverer. He'll bring you out. He'll do this. And then when Monday comes, woe is me. See, when you have a revelation of the Lord, when you know how good he's been to you, even in the midst of trials and tribulations, you'll shout. What I want to talk about today is, we're talking about patience, but let me say this. I need you all to hear me today. You know how we go to work and we start a job and we have a career, and you know how we make certain that things are good for retirement. How many folk in here retired? Getting a little piece of check every month. We make certain that things are well for retirement, and we look forward to the day that we're going to retire. I need you all to hear me here this morning. Every Christian here this morning, you are not here to stay. I need you to hear me this morning. Just like when you go to that job, you know eventually I'm going to retire. You're going to leave here. If the Lord tarries his coming, we're going to die. And what we're really going to do is we're going to transition. But listen, when a person goes to college, and they get accepted into college, you know, they're excited. But when they go to college, they get a curriculum. The curriculum says, in order for you to get this degree, you have to complete and achieve this. And what they do is they work to achieve that. And sometimes we go on for multiple degrees. But listen, you don't go to college, try to build you a house on campus and live there and stay. Why? Because it's not designed for you to stay there. It's designed for you to go accomplish what you need to accomplish so you can go on. And so what is it that you're concerned with while you're there? You're concerned with your GPA. What's your GPA? What's your GPA? And the reason we're concerned with GPA is because we know graduation is coming. Graduation is coming, and we want to prepare ourselves well in college, so when we get ready to present ourselves to companies to work, they'll say, well done. They read this morning, 3.8 GPA. We want to do things. Now listen, while we're in college, they said Brother Joseph and Joshua has been accepted into the sonic boom. There are things while we're in college we want to do. We want to have fun. We want to show that, you know, we're doing. In this life, I need you to understand this. You are not here to stay. You're not here to stay. And so many times we prepare for retirement well, better than we do on the other side of this life. Let's look at verse 12. Verse 12 say, blessed is the man that endureth temptation. For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Hupomano, that's he that endureth. That means he that remains or abide, who does not retreat. Let me tell you something. When it get hard, don't run. The Bible says endure hardness as a good soldier. When it get hard, you don't run. And so note this. Listen.
It says, for when he is tried, he shall be received the crown of life, which the Lord had promised to them that love him. This is not talking about eternal life. We already saved. I need you to hear me. It may sound like he's giving them the crown of life. No, he said, I'll give you the crown of life. If you ain't saved, you better get eternal life first. He said, I'll give to him the crown of life. And what this actually is this is called the martyr's crown. This is called the martyr's crown. You don't have to turn there, but you can write it down. In Revelation 2:10, he was writing to the church at Smyrna. And this is what he said. He said, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison that ye may be tried. And ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. He's talking about a particular crown. He's talking about a particular reward. It's not eternal life. Now, let me say this. Salvation is free. Your entrance into heaven is free. Y'all with me? Come on, Pastor. Do you hear me? Yeah. Let me say it like this. If they say tonight at Malco, you can get in free, they may let you in the movie free, but the popcorn gonna cost you $10. You get in free, but your reward, see, your salvation is based on what Jesus did. Your reward is based on what you do. Thank you for those three witnesses. Salvation, you get in based on what Jesus did, but your reward is based on what you do. Don't spend your life here like this is it. He said, he that endureth, I'll give him the crown of life. Real quick, let me tell you, there are five crowns mentioned. This first one is the crown of life. The second one is called the crown of rejoicing. There's a crown of rejoicing. In 2 Thessalonians 2:19, it says, for what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming? There's a crown of rejoicing. There's also a crown of righteousness. So, well, Pastor, what are these? These are rewards. I told you before, some folk going to go to heaven looking for a crown, and they ain't going to even get an earring. So many people have preached to us that when I get saved, I'm going to go to heaven. They're going to put a neck brace on because I'm going to have a big crown. I ain't done nothing for the Lord. The crown of righteousness, 2 Timothy 4:8 says, henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. Listen, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at the day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. How many, when the Lord comes back, gonna love his appearing? Those that's ready. Now listen, when they post the graduation roster of everybody graduating, they'll say all of these have met all the criteria to graduate. But summa cum laude, and some thank you laude. Why? All are graduating, but the way you graduate, it depends on how you perform. That's your doing. And so what I need you to understand in this, you got to have patience, because see, if you don't have patience, you'll look like you're double-minded. The next crown is called the crown of glory. 1 Peter 5:4 says, and when the chief shepherd shall appear, you shall receive a crown of glory that faded not away. What you talking about, Pastor? I thought I was just going to be saved. Yeah, but you got to know the rewards that are available. I've seen people go to the administrative office, admissions or records or whatever, and they'll say something is on my transcript that does not supposed to be here. And they'll shake that university tree until they fix it. Why? Because, see, this messes up my GPA. What is your GPA in heaven? What is your GPA in heaven? Listen, the crown of righteousness is not given to you because you ushered well. I don't cry how you sang in the inspirational choir. Who have you gotten saved? How have you ministered to the homeless? How have you ministered to orphans? What have you done to advance the kingdom of God? And then lastly, there's an incorruptible crown. In 1 Corinthians 9, 24 through 27, he talks about an incorruptible crown. That's five different crowns mentioned there. And I'm going to tell you this. If you're going to get to heaven and get a crown, you ought to look like it and act like it on earth. I hope that came out right. So if you mean as a snake, you say, but you mean as a snake, and you're ready to get to heaven and stroll around with your crown on, what am I talking about? The Bible says, let patience have a perfect work. Listen, patience needs to work in your life, because if you don't have patience in your life, you don't develop. It says so that you may be perfect and entire, so that you are maturing, so that you are developing. Every time something get hard in your life, stop running. Stop acting double-minded. Stop acting like, why do I have to go through anything? If Jesus went through something, why shouldn't you? But what are we to demonstrate here on earth? We are here to demonstrate the power of God in you. Listen. Y'all know the Energizer Bunny commercial. If you take the batteries out, the bunny stops. But as long as the bunny got batteries, you got the Spirit of God on the inside of you. What you stopping for? As long as you got the Spirit of God on the inside of you, you got to make something happen. So sometimes when things happen in your life that may seem hard, just go on. Anybody ever had a baby in here? I felt a pain, so I ain't gonna push no more. What's wrong? It hurts. Sometimes you just have to push and press through the hurt. But this is my question to you this morning. Can we lose our crown? Can we lose our crown? Revelation 3:11, he says, behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast. Listen, that no man take thy crown. He ain't talking about taking your salvation. Because see, salvation is eternal. It's called eternal life. Listen, y'all, it's called, how many of you born again this morning? Let me ask you a question again. How many of you born again this morning? If you have eternal life, it's eternal. He's not talking about taking your eternal life, but so many times we're right on the cuff of something major happening in our lives, and because it's uncomfortable. But he's saying here, can you lose your reward? Now let me say this. We all have an appointment at the judgment seat of Christ. Church, look up. I've taught this before. We are not talking about the great white throne judgment. That is not the judgment you're going to. If you're born again, let me say this. All of those that have their name on the official graduation roster, they're graduating. They all got on their robes and they're lined up. They're going in. They're going in at different levels. So we're not talking about the great white throne judgment here, but we're talking about the bema seat of Christ. What is the bema seat of Christ? The bema seat of Christ is where believers go to get their stuff. So what happens is you show up at the bema seat and he says, you've been good. Brother Jalen, you've been good. You've been faithful. Come on over here. Hold your head down. And then put a crown on your head. Some are going to go to the Bema seat. He's going to say, you made it. So glad I made it. So glad. He's going to say, you made it. But listen, at the great white throne judgment, that's not the Bema seat. The great white throne judgment is going to be like Jackson State. We graduate in blue robes. And here come one in a red robe. Wrong school. The great white throne judgment is where they go, and he's going to tell them, I don't know you. But we go to the Bema seat. This is what I'm going to say this morning. Listen, listen. You got to let patience work in your life. Because let me tell you, I told you last Sunday, don't ever pray for patience. You don't pray for patience. Because if you pray for patience, you're asking for a trial. Send me a trial. Well, Pastor, I don't believe that. I got a question. How many of you this morning have gone through something in your life and now you're better as a result? Let me tell you why. Because see, you went through something. When you begin asking for patience, you're saying, Lord, send me something else. Basically, you're saying, Lord, allow me to go through something else. This is one thing I said last Sunday that was very interesting. Any trial that comes through your life is Christ-filtered. It's Christ-filtered. I need you to hear me this morning. If the trial comes in your life, it's Christ-filtered. Because he's not going to let you his child. He ain't going to let something come up on you that he don't want to come your way. When you cook at your house, actually, parents, a lot of times there are certain things that if you're not sure that it's good for your child, you'll taste it. He's not going to allow something to come to his children that's not filtered. I asked last Sunday, how many of us are 8-2-8ers? Romans 8:28. For we know that all things work together. If the Lord allows it to come to you, the Lord is going to strengthen you to get through it. But it requires patience. It requires patience. And so, Revelation 22 and 12, he says, and behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give to every man according to his work. To give to every man according to his work. Well, Pastor, what are you saying? This is what I'm saying this morning. The work that the Lord has called us to is greater than the inspirational choir. It's greater than the usher board. It's greater than Sunday school. We do all of this to be equipped and prepared for the work. You know, in Firestone, when you take your car to Firestone and they fix it, do you know they're not in there driving your car? They're getting your car ready so you can drive it. We come into this house, we receive poured into us. Why? So we can go out and do the work. But I want to say something to you this morning. Because that's what the devil will do. You know, I used to minister. I used to go out and minister to the lost. But my child got on drugs. And now I spend all my time. What I need you to know this morning is this. The Bible tells us that we ought to let patience have its perfect work. And so when we operate in patience, what we're saying to the Lord is, Lord, I know you're going to move. Lord, I trust you. Job, three friends, they came and told him all kind of stuff. Job said, y'all gone. Job's wife said, why don't you curse God and die? Job says, no, I know God. And what I want to say to you this morning is when something began to happen in your life, I need you to lean towards what God has placed in your heart to do. Sometimes you want to camp and you want to stay there and you want to just nurture whatever is going on. You give attention to that and you pray. But this is what I need you to do. I need you to focus on God and his word. I need you to focus on God and his will. The things that happen in our lives, yes, sometimes they're real. Yes, sometimes we want them to stop. But this morning, I want you to understand something. What I'm saying, when I pray to God and I believe God is going to move, the way I respond really means, do I believe God or do I not? Do I believe God or do I not? But Pastor, what happened if I'm hurting? Lay it on altar. What happens if I'm hurting? And lay it on the altar. Because what you need to know is this. God is able to make all grace abound towards you. God is able to make all grace abound towards you. So sometimes I don't try to tell people how they feel, because how they feel may be how they feel. When you go to the doctor don't tell you don't feel that. He just gives you a prescription. He gives you a prescription that'll adjust the feeling. And so what we have to do is, in patience, oh, y'all just don't know my husband. He's just such and such and such and such. You used to be the same way. And God waited on you. We have to have patience, because patience will work in our life. And when patience works in our life, it develops us. Sometimes on a job, you begin to be challenged and tried. And what's actually happening is you're being prepared for a promotion. But because you don't like being challenged and tried, you quit the job. Sometimes in your life, when God gets ready to take you to another level, he will allow you to go through something. You know what? Job was a rich man. Y'all know that, right? But when the end came, he was richer. He got double. All the camel, all the sheep, all the servants. The only thing didn't double was the children. But the truth of the matter is, the 10 he had was still his. See, God gave him 10 more, which gave him 20 children. The other 10 had gone on to heaven. They had gone on to the bosom of Abraham. But the truth of the matter is, Job endured. And this is what I love. When you endure, when you wait on God, when you trust God, when you say, Lord, I can't handle it. Lord, I can't fix it. Lord, I tried. I'm going to take my hands off of it. Lord, I trust you anyhow. It don't matter how I feel. It don't matter what they're saying. It don't matter what they're doing. I'm going to trust you anyhow. It don't matter how it looks. It don't matter what the report is. I'm going to trust you. When you do that, when it's over, you're on a different level. And so you got to let patience work inside of your life. 1 Corinthians 9:26-27. And I'm closing. It says, I therefore so run, not as uncertainty. So fight I, not as one that beateth the air. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I preach to others, I myself should be a castaway. Here he says, I run and I fight. Let me say this to you this morning. What you have to realize is the Bible told us to fight the good fight of faith. He says, I don't fight like I'm fighting the air. I don't fight like I'm fighting the air. But what he says is, I fight and I run. This morning, I want you to understand something. That when in this life, when you realize that I name the name of Jesus, the Spirit of God lives on the inside of me, don't become like pigeons. You know the difference between a pigeon and an eagle? There's a difference between a pigeon and an eagle. Pigeons get on your nerves. Pigeons are, they're a nuisance. They love to be in the middle of a lot of folk, and they're scrapping here and there. But it's strange. A person will say, I saw an eagle. Where? I was in Durant, Mississippi, and I saw an eagle. But when's the last time somebody got excited that they saw a pigeon? But the scripture, when he refers to us, we'll mount up like on wings like eagles. And as born again believers, this morning I need you to understand something. You got to have patience. You got to allow God to work in your life. And this is what you have to realize. This is what I love about the eagle. When the storm comes, the eagle will fly above the storm. The eagle will fly above the storm. Now listen, the eagle don't stop the storm. He just fly above it. Sometimes when stuff is going on in your life, when stuff is going on, you need to ascend higher. Why? Because the Bible says in Ephesians that we've been seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus, far above. And so what we have to do is we have to learn to soar above it. Don't let people pull you down to act like a pigeon. What she say, what he say, what you think, what you believe. Don't get into that. You do like the eagle. You take the high road. You mount up. An eagle can stretch out those wings and they'll just soar. They'll soar. They'll soar. Philippians 3, 8, 4, 13 and 14, and I'm closing. It says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark. I press. I have to exert some energy. I press toward the mark. I press toward the mark. All that stuff is happening around me. The doctor's report, the reports from my job, the street committee, all that is true. But I press. And this morning, somebody here, you need to forget some stuff. There's some stuff that has happened in your life. Everybody may know about it and some may not. But you need to forget the stuff behind you. And you need to say, Lord, you've forgiven me. I cast it aside and I'm pressing. I'm pressing towards the things that are before me. Everybody may not know it. It may have been something you did in the dark. But this morning, you need to go ahead and tell the devil, I got amnesia. I don't remember it. I've confessed it to the Lord. He's forgiven me of it. And you gotta press. There's a blessing in your pressing. You gotta press. And so don't you let what has happened in your past stop what God has ordained for your future. I wanna say it again. Don't you let what's happened in your past stop what God has ordained for your future. Paul said, one thing I do. What is it this morning you need to forget? What is that, that has happened in your life that's trying to hinder you, that the devil is trying to make you feel condemned about? See, one thing I love is God has patience with us. But what is it in your life that you did, that you may be doing, that's causing you to feel so condemned? Paul said, I don't count myself to have arrived. I don't count myself to have arrived. But let me tell you what I do. Those things behind me that happened from Saturday on back, I forget those things. And this morning, if you would just dump off some stuff. Some of you can't soar because you got too much weighted on you. This morning, if you could forget about some stuff. And just be free. Woo, I'm telling you, listen, if you ain't never been free in the Lord, that's a good feeling, Pastor. If you ain't never been free in the Lord, if you've never soared in the Lord, because see, once you receive his word and understand and agree with what his word says about you, it don't matter what they're saying in the street. It don't matter what they're saying at work. It don't matter how you feel. It doesn't matter how it looks when you know what his word says. You will soar. You gotta understand that in your life, when you begin to go through stuff, don't make that the highlight of your day. How you doing, Brother Josh? Oh, I tell you the truth. No! In the life of a believer, the Bible says that when we pray, he hears us. The Bible says that when we pray, He hears us. And if he hears us, then he'll grant us the petitions that we make according to his will. So once you stop, once you settle down, and once you pray to the Father, you just get up and say, how you doing? I'm fine. All is well. I'm blessed and highly favored. I'm blessed going in. I'm blessed coming out. He supplies all my needs. He turns my midnight into day. He makes my mouth filled with laughter. I sing unto the Lord a new song. Don't do that. Because when the devil begin to mess with you about what you did, you tell him, I'm getting fitted for my crown. I'm getting fitted for my crown. But in order to do that, you got to learn to wait. You got to have patience. Anybody blessed by the word this morning? Every head bowed. There may be one here today. You'll say, Pastor, I don't know Jesus. If you're here today and you've never received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the altar is open for you this morning. Or if you're here and you say, Pastor, I don't have a church home. I need a church home where they're going to preach and teach me the word and disciple me. If that's you this morning, we invite you to come. Greater Favreau is the church where love prevails over hate. And it's a good place for you. There'll be one this morning that says, Pastor, pray for me. Pray for me. I need to know Jesus. Pastor, pray for me. Amen. Some of you just may need to shake off some stuff. Everybody grab the person's hand next to you and repeat after me. Lord Jesus, if the persons whose hand I hold, if they need to make a decision, I pray that they make it and that they make it now. And that when this prayer is over, that they'll get up and they'll walk these aisles for Jesus. Now listen, let that person's hand go, and the persons whose hand that you were holding on, look over to them and ask them, do you need to make a decision today? Look at them. Tell them, if they say yes, say, I'll walk down with you. So everybody talk to the person next to you. Say, if you need to make a decision today, I'll walk with you. There'll be another this morning. In the name of Jesus. Everybody, you may have been too shy to walk the aisles this morning, but listen, we don't want anybody to leave here without an opportunity to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. If you're here this morning and you know you're not saved, the Bible says that if we believe in our heart on the Lord Jesus, if you believe that in your heart and confess him with your mouth, thou shalt be saved. So this morning, if you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he was born of a virgin and crucified on a cross for you, the only thing next is to confess him with your mouth. So this morning, I want everybody in this building to repeat after me. God in heaven, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He was born of a virgin, crucified on a cross, buried in a tomb, and raised with all power. He now resides at the right hand of the Father. Lord Jesus, I confess you as my Lord and Savior, and I invite you to come into my heart and live inside of me for the rest of my days. Thank you, Lord, that I'm saved. I'm saved. I am saved in Jesus' name. Clap your hands in the presence. Listen, this morning, Sister Nakia Pigs is coming for prayer because she's having surgery. Amen. Your mom, her mom is having surgery tomorrow. Amen. She trusts and believes God for healing. Amen. And Sister Victoria Fields, she is coming for rededication. Come on, clap your hands. Re means again. I said re means again. And the Bible says that we are to make disciples of men. And so this morning, we're going to pray for Sister Pigs first. for her mom. Stretch your hands towards her this morning. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for Mother Pinks this morning, Father God, as she prepares to go into surgery tomorrow. Father, we pray that your hand be upon her, that your hand be upon the surgeons and all of the medical professionals that administer to her. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that she has a successful surgery and a speedy recovery. We yoke our faith up, Father God, with hers, believing, Father God, that you'll watch over her and keep her. In the name of Jesus, and we trust you that it is done in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord, church. Sister Victoria is coming for rededication. That means you're already saved, right? You want to rededicate your life to the Lord. Church, somebody ought to be excited in here. Let me tell you something this morning. God loves you. You know that, don't you? He loves you so much. And the fact that you've been moved by the Spirit to come and rededicate your life, saying, Lord, I want to go higher. Lord, I want more of you, and I want to give you all of me. And so what I want you to do this morning, I'm going to send you to the room after I pray for you, for our ministers to minister to you. But I want you to understand something, that whatever you commit to the Lord, he's able to keep it. And so this morning, as you lift your hands to the Lord, lift both your hands to the Lord as I pray for you. God loves you. Jesus died for you. He ever lives to make intercession for you. And once you rededicate today, don't you ever let the devil convince you of anything other than that. Stretch your hands, church. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for your dear child right now who's already saved. But Father, she's been moved by the word this morning, and she has come to rededicate her life to you. Thank you, Lord, for your Spirit. Thank you that your Spirit draws. And Father, I pray for her right now. Father, that you will bless her. Father, I pray that she'll walk in the newness of life, that she'll walk in freedom and no condemnation, no bondage. Father, you'll anoint her afresh to be even a better Christian, a better mother, Father God. And thank you for her desire to be even committed to you. I pray in Jesus' name that you keep her by your power. I pray that you strengthen her. And Father God, everything that she stands in need of, I pray, Father, that you minister to her. And all of those that need to be sown into her life to consistently minister to her, sow them in the name of Jesus, Father God, that they'll continue to cross her path. Bless her and keep her like only you can. In Jesus' name. Come on, church. Let's thank God. Amen. God bless you. You can return to your seat. Sister Victoria, I want you to go to the back. Amen. Amen. Our deacon's going to minister to you back there. How many of you thank God for his word this morning? And I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to tell you something. When somebody comes to the altar for rededication, some of you ought to lose your mind like it's your child. I'm going to say it again. When somebody comes to the altar for rededication, you ought to act like it's your child. Why? Because that's somebody's prayer been answered in Jesus' name. I think the Lord deserves some more praise this morning. Come on, bless the Lord in this place. God deserves some praise in this place. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I pray you've been blessed. Reverend Green is coming with our closing announcements this morning. Amen. I'm encouraged. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Don't you give up your patience to the devil. Don't you give up your patience to the devil. I don't care how it feels. Don't you give up your patience. Because the devil is trying to, I can't say that word, but the devil trying to mess with you to cause you to believe that God ain't real. He already knows he's a defeated foe. He's messing with you because he knows if you hold on to your faith, see, he ain't got no weapon against a believer in faith. He knows if you hold on to your faith, that after a while, that thing gonna turn around. Come on, Reverend Green, pray.
I just have a few words I want to leave you here before we dismiss. We want to thank God for that word and thank God for Pastor Russell. Family, please remember our activities for this week are as follows. Prayer Warriors call Tuesday at noon. Tuesday Prayer Warriors at noon. Wednesday morning prayer at 7 a.m. Bible class Wednesday, 7 p.m. And remember, and worship again in spirit and in truth. And everyone who loves our God, shout!